Today is Saturday, April the 2th. It's bee moving day. I'm very excited about bee moving day. Spring is always very stressful, and getting the bees out is one step in relieving some of that stress for bees and beekeeper alike. The weather forecast in the next week or so is not particularly warm, but it's not particularly cold. So we're looking at here, we're looking at highs of 5, lows of, you know, -4, -5, which I'm okay with. That's not remarkably different than what they're putting up with in the building. The wind is a different factor. So, we're going to reduce entrances, etc. But what I need to do is I need to get syrup on as soon as I can. I got some sugar yesterday. That needs to be mixed up. I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to use my big mixer for that, but I'm going to move that direction. If I can't, 5-gallon pail and a paint mixer is what it's going to have to be. So you may remember my syrup mixer in a different video. It has a 1,000-liter IBC tote and a pump, etc. And that was a 2-inch pump. My pump has been really, really hard to deal with. Hard to start. Running pretty good, but hard to start, mostly. And so I bought a new pump. I got a pump on sale. It's a 3-inch pump because it was on sale cheaper than the 2-inch. So I bought that. So I need to adapt my inlet outlet to the 3-inch pump because all my plumbing on the mixer is 2-inch. So that's what I'm kind of going to do right here. So this is what comes with the pump. And these fittings are always kind of garbage. It's just a pot metal thing. I usually throw them in the junk, but that's good for sizing. So that's a 3-inch thread-on unit. So the pump, then, you can say, has a 3-inch threaded female fitting on the pump. Okay, so I'm going to replace that with this. So that'll thread on to that pump. But then that gets me to 3-inch. So I need to go with this, glue that in to get me to 2-inch. But I still don't have then a 2-inch female thread to go onto my existing fitting, which is what this is. So I glue that onto there, but I need a little short piece of pipe for that. So I've got one on here. I have to make 2 of them, of course. So I need to cut this pipe off about here and glue that together. And glue that into there and glue that into there. And so that's what I'm doing right here. Okay, so here's how I'm going to do this. Get these 2 big ones glued in here first. That one. Put that aside for now. I'm no master at this. Here's what I've figured out. I like the glue. You just spin it around in there. Don't use a modicum of glue. Get lots of glue on there, but don't go too crazy. I like to do the inside one first, because it's going to sit there and not drip glue everywhere. Now this one, there's nothing to hang on to here because it's so short. Some might say take that label off, and that's probably good advice. I know those labels really stick on there and are a pain, so. So just shove that in there, give it a twist. Boy. A big circumference like that is difficult because it has to go in square, and if it's not square, it kind of binds. Just want to clean up some of this glue. Sticky, messy stuff. Okay. Time here. So if you're wondering why I do 2, it's inlet outlet, right? Gotta have a fitting on each side.
And I'll show that system when I get it out, hooked up, if you're not sure what I mean by my syrup mixing system. So we're nicely covered in glue here. You got an actual fitting, you can grab it, give it a twist, but these, there's nothing there to grab. Just push it down. Wipe up the glue. Okay. So those are together. Now next, I need a piece that's about twice that long, so only about that long. I'd like it to be as short as possible, so I'm not starting to have a big thing sticking out of the pump. It makes for a lot of torsion and stress on the pump. I think I'm gonna glue that, and then I'll cut it. So I'll just glue that. Glue this. And there's such thing as primer. I think primer you use if you're gluing two pieces together that are made of different material. So you normally give it a twist like that, it helps it spread the glue inside there. Make a good seal. So I'm gonna glue this one on the other end. Clean that a bit. Get the dust off it. You ought to use enough glue, but I've seen some people do this and there's glue absolutely everywhere. Okay, that's a little too much. So now I need to cut these off so they fit in there. And the easiest thing I've found to use for that is my, it's called a hacksaw. It's a little sawzall kind of a thing. Hacksaw. A hacksaw is what you want. This is just a power hacksaw. Makes a perfectly square and flat cut, but it's good enough, right? It's the Krusty the Clown seal of approval. It's not only good, it's good enough. And again, in lieu of the proper tools, I'm just going to use a file. That crap falls off pretty fast. I just want to make sure that edge is not too sharp, and you don't want a burr that goes on the outside because that has to go inside the other fitting. So I'll just scrape the inside off. This one has got kind of weird, but that's not going to hurt anything. Not in this application. Oh, the septic pump went in last night. I'm very sore and I'm very tired. That is quite a job. I'm not a plumber, so I often don't do things maybe in the most efficient and easiest manner. Sometimes I end up doing things more than once. You know, it's hard to just figure out sometimes what order to put things together in, and sometimes you get things together in a certain order and it's not working for you. So that's going to just go right in there. I'll just test fit it And that's not going to fit. I've got a burr here that I didn't take off. Fits. So I've got these cleaned now and they both fit in there. Get the dust off of them and glue them up. I'm not sure of the time I need to wait before using this, but honestly, it'll likely be more than 24 hours before I use it. So there's my adapter, 3-inch female to 2-inch male. Bing bang boom. My home hardware, Selkirk Home Hardware, they are just the most helpful people. You know, I came from the city, lived in the city for years. And you know, you go into a hardware store in the city, gosh, it's unlikely you're gonna find anybody who knows more about the products than you do. I just go in home hardware and I say, I got a 3-inch pump and I got a 2-inch fitting to put on it. How do I adapt that? And the guy just walks around and he grabs all the pieces and says, here you go. And here's the glue. They're awesome. I really like that store. So there you go. That is the fittings I need for my new pump. I hope it works. Boy, that's a big step down, eh? I hope that pump doesn't have problems pulling that much syrup in. Building is holding at 3.5 degrees. And there's some things to move out here. A bunch of honey stored here. It'll take me a few minutes to move that out and clean up. I've got all these panels on top, all kinds of things. So there's lots to do in here yet. I'm not going to stir the bees up. I'm not going to open the doors till this is all done. It's Sunday, April 3rd, 2022. Thought I'd take a page out of my mentor's book and get up before the sun and get some bees moved. Actually, I'm totally kidding. No, I'm not kidding. It's early, but it's not pitch black out here. A little tractor sat outside last night. I think he'll start up okay. He's a good starter. He just has 10W30 oil, so it gets kind of thick when it gets cold.
I hope he starts up because he's key to this operation today. It's about 6:30 a.m. in the blessed morning. And the landscape is frozen overnight. So I need to do this while that is the case, because yesterday I got shut down by mud. The apiary got so unbelievably muddy that I just couldn't do it anymore. We got about two-thirds, I think, of the colonies out. What I saw looked pretty good. They were a bit light, so we got some syrup on some of them. And so I hope to get the rest out today. So I'm going to go open the barn up, get the tractor started, and we'll get this show on the road. That's what I have left to do. Quite a few trips across the yard. It looks like it's pretty firm out there, but I'm not sure how deep the frost goes. It's gonna be a rough ride with the frozen ground though, because there's ruts everywhere. But I gotta get at this. This is the moment you realize that you made your apiary too small. I think there's 163 colonies here or something like that. And one giant mud hole. So they're all out now, and the assessments begin. So far, the ones that have pails there have been assessed, and they're about 8% loss. So I'm thoroughly happy with that. So we'll see what the rest of these count up as.
Here's my advice on pumps. If you're going to bother to waste money on a pump, you better spend a little bit extra and get a Honda pump. Now this thing's brand new, so you'd expect it to work well. But this brand new engine, and this is not a Honda pump, this is a Power Fist pump out of Princess Auto, but it's a Honda engine. You're looking at $500 to $600, closer to $600 I think. Anyway, brand new engine, I put oil in it, I put gas in it, that thing fired up, ready to go on a second pull. And it's got a compression release system where it's really easy to pull. That old pump that I have, man, that is just a bear to pull. They keep breaking the recoil cord, actually. So, I'm thoroughly impressed so far. I'll get this thing hooked up. I gotta relocate my pallets a little bit to align everything, and we'll get some water in the tank and we'll make some syrup.
I had a bit of a brain fart last fall, and I'd stored a bunch of jars. There's like 60 jars or something here, way in here, in some pallets, in some boxes. So I had to get my tractor and bucket and clean out all the snow, and then barely get to them at that, but I got them. There's a pallet load here, so there's not quite enough for what I need, but we'll use them and we'll go from there.
Okay, I'm going to mix up a little bit of syrup here. Not nearly this whole tote. What I got is, I got 18 bags, and a partial is about a half there, and about 200 liters of water. So this is going to, in theory, give me about a 1.8 ratio. People stress about ratios a lot. I want to encourage you not to. You're not going to do it wrong, and the bees are not going to refuse it if you make it a different ratio. Now, having said that, in the spring, you can get away with thinner syrup than the fall, because the fall they need to dry it and store it for winter stores. So it should be as thick as possible, really. And in the spring, I know Bob Binney talks about giving them light syrup to stimulate brooding, I think he says. So that's a reason to give them thinner syrup. I'm not going to tell you if Bob's wrong. Thicker syrup lasts longer before it sours.
I'm always a little shy to make thin syrup for fear that it might sour. I'm not making that much. I'm only giving a couple liters to every colony, and so they should take that down quickly enough that it shouldn't have time to sour. And the weather is cool, so that'll also help mitigate the souring of the syrup. So I'm going to get my new Honda pump going and dump those bags in here. I haven't got my camera set up, so I can't really film the whole action process, but you've kind of seen that before. I ran out of my gallon pails for feeding, and I had 76, I believe, that didn't get fed. There's a few dead ones. Not many, about 10% at this point. But I haven't done comprehensive assessments, so there might be some weak ones that are going to let go yet. So I raided my old supply of half-gallon mason jars, and I had quite a few, so that was nice. I mixed up the syrup in the tank and filled these. I still came up short, so I had some quart jars, and I didn't have enough. So I raided my wife's closet, and I got a few more brand new quart jars here. I think I have enough now. So now the long, arduous job of walking a million miles to distribute these, and kind of the problem is I can't drive around with the tractor to do it. So I got to walk. Oh, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to get my wagon. It's in the shed over here, and I'm going to put these in a wagon so I can drag it around. That'll work. Well, the wagon holds a lot. There's 50 of those half-gallon jars in there. So, I mean, that's 25 gallons of syrup that's going to be heavy. But I'm sure it'll take it. Well, I know it'll take it. It's got a very heavy rating on that. So off I go. Well, everybody's fed. That was hard enough even with the wagon. It doesn't make as big a mess, but it's really hard to pull around. So that's it. So there's a lot of these dead outs. The lid's upside down on the dead outs, you know. We've got a few. There's one here. We're looking about 10% loss at this point. I'm pretty happy with that number. Could lose perhaps almost that many yet, because April dwindle is a real thing. It ain't over till the fat lady sings, and she don't sing until the 1st of May. That's my saying. But I'm happy everybody's fed. The weather is going to be kind of not very warm, but not very cold, coming up the next number of days. So the apiary is an absolute muddy, messy, wet, disgusting mess. I can't even walk. So there you go, that's my Sunday. I think I'm taking Monday off. It is April the 4th, 2022, and the barn fan is quiet. There's space in that building. Not for long, I'll fill it up. Stuff everywhere. It was a very busy weekend. Got the syrup tank here. It's got some syrup in it, little tractor sitting outside. Today's job is I gotta unload. There's some cargo in the little truck here. Need to unload that. Load up some honey and go and visit some stores. And that's, you know, it's always kind of fun. Gas prices is, you know, you have to try to be as efficient as you can. So I kind of have a few stores in a particular direction, and I can go visit those all in one day. Save a couple of bucks in gas. It's noon. I mean, I've been up a while, but I had such a busy weekend. I worked all day Sunday, 6:30 I started. And I got a really good sleep, so I'm happy about that. I'm rested. I'm still chugging through the coffee, though. And so that's the plan today. That's the plan today. Get the little truck unloaded and get the truck loaded. Get to the stores. I would like to do assessments today. It's going to be rainy and snowy for the next couple days, though. So I can't do it then. But I guess I still got wood shop work to do. So that's maybe what I'll be doing tomorrow and Wednesday. So that's today. You know, sometimes one thing leads to another. I just came out here to bring some things out to see Canon. This looks so awful. And I know it's going to rain and snow for 2 days, so it's going to get even worse. So I did some digging with the tractor, I did some digging with the spade, and it's actually draining from here. It's draining all the way there, down there, through there between the hives and out the back. So is it perfect? No, not by long ways. Is it a big, huge, bloody mess? Yes, it is. That's all I can do right now. People say, oh yeah, fill it with gravel. Well, you can give me about $3,000 or $4,000, I'll fill it with gravel. Then I would love that. It's just not in the cards. So anyway, I lifted a couple of those white pails and they're empty already. Pails are, jars are still looking good, but they're going down a little bit. So I need to collect the pails and fill them up again. But I have to go to the store, so I can't do that today. Might have to do that in the snow and rain tomorrow. We'll see. I'm back from my store run, and that took me, I don't know, 3 hours, maybe a little more. And it was a really good run, really good run. I had a bunch of stores that were hungry on the way and the way back. And so I invoiced quite a bit of product, which is nice. Got a whack of empty boxes here, which empty boxes, I always say, empty boxes, money in the bank, right? Almost 30-day invoices, so not quite, but it's nice to have those invoices come in over time. I didn't take a video with me dressed up in my non-work clothes. I would say my clean clothes, but, you know, for store visits, I'm not dressed as nice on the farm as I am visiting stores, of course. And so now what I need to do is I need to go and see how I can go collect those little pails that we put on Saturday. Look at this. She always wants to be around when I'm talking. And the challenge there is going to be I can't drive my tractor in the apiary, so it's going to be a lot of walking involved. Best I can maybe drive it to the fence line there, to the entrance where the gravel is. He's banging into me. And go get those pails. I think I have enough syrup I can fill the pails because they've emptied them. I've checked a few and they've emptied them. So we need to make sure they have enough feed. I'd really like to get that on right now because next 2 days is going to be snow and rain. Not terribly cold, still above zero, but snow and rain anyway. So I was going to say it's March, anything can happen, but it's April, so anything can still happen. So I'm going to go get some of those pails, hopefully. Oh, and clean up this mess too. Put some of this away. I don't leave the creamed honey in the truck in the summer. And this isn't quite summer, but it still kind of can get warm with the sun on the tonneau cover and in the cab. In winter, everything stays in the truck. It just freezes solid. So that's all good. But summer, the creamed honey has to be kept in a building that's not too hot. So that it doesn't separate and break down. The liquid honey can stay in the truck. It likes being warm. So that's kind of why I'm cleaning out empty boxes and cleaning out the creamed honey now. I would say this has drained quite a bit in the last 4 hours or so. It's still running through here, little trickles. It's the problem. It's melting out of the bush and it's coming right across here. So I don't know if I can... I don't know if I can stop that from happening. Oh, well,
I just got to give it a place to go, I guess. I really need to make, just make a little run right through the middle of the apiary here, I guess. Trouble is, anytime that there's, the ground's not frozen, there's bees here. But I guess I just have to deal with that. Once I get the outyards in use this year, then there should be, you know, there should only be about this many hives here through the summer. Everything else should be going to outyards, so then I can maybe squeeze things together a bit here and then work on some landscaping here. Put a little draw in the middle there and get that water somewhere to go. Because that's really what you need. Drainage is so important to be able to access land. So I have to go and collect all these pails. Like, there's even some, you know, little pails way over here and way over here and all through here, and I have to carry them all up, and this is as close as I can get with my tractor. So there's going to be a lot of walking here. All right, maybe I can get my wagon involved. Shouldn't be too bad to pull around if I stay out of the mud. And the pails aren't very heavy, but I can't fit that many in there, so I don't know. I'll try it and see what happens. Well, I got home at 4:30, and it's now 20 after 7. So I've been to the apiary, picked up 68 gallon pails, brought them over here, filled them up with my mixer pump thing, and then taken them back. I had to take them back in 3 loads though, and so every trip from here to there is just horrendous. So much mud. And I couldn't even get in the apiary, so using the wagon again to ferry them throughout the apiary, which actually worked really well. Just a little time consuming. But I am beat. I am really wore out. I'm so glad everybody's fed. 68 have a gallon, and 76 have, well, most of that 76 has a half a gallon, but some of them just have a quart. So gonna have to watch those quarts and change those out as soon as they need it. We've got quite a little bit of syrup left here, so that's good. I've mixed up 25 bags of syrup so far in here. I don't remember how much that made. I think it made 400 or 500 liters, something like that. Mixing it pretty thick. My confidence in the pails not to leak is kind of one of the biggest things that makes me want to mix it thick. Thin syrup leaks out a little bit better. So, I'm going to go in. I'm going to have some supper and spend the evening with my wife. And more shenanigans tomorrow. Bad weather for a couple days, they say. So, woodshop, it sounds like. Today is Tuesday, April the 5th, 2022. And if I sound unsure, I am. sometimes the days just kind of meld together, and it's a little bit of a blur. This last few days have been a blur. It's been so busy moving the bees out, etc. Didn't really get a weekend, didn't really get a Sunday. And I don't like to make a habit of that, because you get wore out pretty fast if you start skipping out on your days of rest. So today, it's not too bad yet. It's a little cool and a bit of a breeze, kind of a north wind. But I had kind of planned to just work in the shop. I got to finish some of these covers. Got quite a few to go. I think about 80 to go. So that'll take me a while yet. And so I started the day off, load up the little truck, and I went to the dump. I went to the post office too, which was good. There was checks in the mail, which is nice. The store is paying for product. Not the product I delivered yesterday. It's 30-day invoices. So I went to the dump and took my recycling. I produce about 2 or 3 times as much recycling as I do garbage, but they've got a good facility there for both. It's good timing, you know, good timing too for someone. On the way back, I noticed there was a vehicle stopped on the side of the highway, hood up. So I stopped and checked, and there's an older fella there. And, you know, he's driving an old vehicle, like, kind of a little bit older than mine,
And I know what it's like to drive old vehicles. So anyway, I asked him if he had a phone. He didn't have a phone. He's, you know, 30, 40 miles from home. It's kind of a cool wind and all that kind of stuff. Just not a good time. So I picked up his auto club card and phoned the auto club and ordered a tow truck for him and get him back to his mechanic and whatnot. So that took a few minutes of my time and not a big deal. Really, you know, we'll make a big deal to him in his day, because what's he going to do? What's he going to do with no phone? He's got to wait for somebody to stop with a phone, because there's not really anything apparently near there on the highway. You know, he's kind of in my neighborhood. It's only a mile and a half from where I live, kind of thing. So I know there's houses and people living all over here, but you don't really know that, and you don't know where to go out on the highway. So anyway, that was good timing for him. And, you know, it always makes you feel good to help somebody out. But, you know, didn't do it for me. Just kind of trying to get the guy out of a jam. Because I know what that's like. I really know what that's like. Old vehicles and cell phones, they're made for each other. So it's cover day. I've got a whole whack of covers here done up, and I don't know what it was, 120 or something here. So I think I've got about 80 to go, and then I can start trimming and doing the finishing touches and get this stuff out of here and get it to the customer. Customer's going to want this stuff soon. It's bee season. I should go check those quart jars out in the apiary, so I'll probably do that today. I've got syrup left over here, so I can refill those few once they're low. So getting at it, and that's today. One of those little jobs I had to do to get underway is to put some honey in my big warming cabinet here. This is the same cabinet I use for melting my pails. I can melt 12 5-gallon pails in here at a time, and it's nice. I can actually load and unload it with the tractor, so no lifting involved there. I can also melt jars. There's some of these that really aren't very far along in granulation, but others that are very much granulated. The honey gets packed liquid, and then it may sit in storage for a period of time and granulate, and then I'll just try and stay ahead of the stores and the customers with liquefying the honey, so that it's, you know, reasonably fresh, and the granulation then will take a considerable amount of time after they get it. I don't have very much granulate on the store shelf, and I don't really have customers coming back and say, hey, my honey granulated. This is a non-canola honey, so it actually stays liquid a long time. Clover and wildflower is what I call it, so it's kind of whatever's in the area, but there's not generally any canola here, so that doesn't accelerate the granulation. Just a better look at what I'm doing here. So I just set these pallets here. I made some rudimentary risers, and so I can fit quite a bit of honey under there, and as you can see, quite a bit up here. Of course, I did try melting honey into boxes. That doesn't work. Boxes are quite well insulated, etc., and it doesn't work. So one of the keys that I try to use is just make sure the honey jars don't touch anything. They don't touch the back or the sides, and they don't touch each other. And this will take I think this takes 12 hours, at least 12 hours, because I don't want it very hot. I'm not going to tell you temperatures, I'm not going to tell you times, because you have to work that out yourself. And unfortunately, I have to, you know, withhold that information, because your honey might be different than mine. Your cabinets or oven or whatever you're using is different than mine. I'm not going to tell you the temperature, I'm not going to tell you the time. But this will take about 12 hours or so in here in my cabinet. I've ruined a lot of honey kind of coming up with the sweet spot on how to do this. So I'll just tell you that. And unfortunately, you're going to have to go through the same thing to figure out how you're going to liquefy your honey reliably without spoiling it. It's Wednesday, April 6th, 2022. It's snowing and blowing again here. It's only about zero, but pretty good wind. I don't know if you can see over here. Oh, the snow is blowing across the field here. Yesterday, it started to rain a little bit late in the day. But otherwise, yesterday was not too bad. It wasn't particularly warm, but it was not too windy. Not snowing, that's for sure. So, building covers today. It's a big surprise. I made out okay yesterday. I don't know how many I built. Maybe 20. I'm not sure. I've been working with different glues. Of course, you know, there's a big glue saga about my very favorite glue is not available. So I've been trying to use different waterproof glues for that project. And I think they're working well. It's just to settle on something. And something that's, you know, economically viable. I'll show you a few of them, actually, that I've been using. You know, this project has been going on for quite a while, and I've got quite a bit invested in it. And I'm not, I don't usually get money up front from people who order stuff. And it really depends on my relationship with that person and the magnitude of the project, etc. And my particular circumstance at that time, I don't have tons of money lying around. You know, this is all equipment that I use, and this is all equipment that I can probably easily sell. So I'm not deathly afraid I'm going to get stuck with it. If it's stuff that I don't use and I don't think I can sell, and you want special builds or something, that's up front. You know, that's up front. But regardless, the principle I wanted to talk about was kind of delayed gratification. You know, and I'm seeing that there's a real lack of that in society today. It's all instant gratification. It's instant this and instant that. I can watch any movie I want on, you know, I was going to say Netflix, but they certainly don't have any movie I want. But, you know, you can stream a movie this minute or in 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Of course, there's no commercials to go to the bathroom, so that's a bad thing. You know, I think it's good training for particularly young people, because the things that you experience when you're young, you carry through your whole life. And I remember one of the good things that happened to me when I was young is I raised pigs. Some people call them hogs. We didn't call them hogs because all of the people on the farm were hogs. So I raised pigs, and I only raised 10 at a time. But you know, I was in grade 9, grade 10, grade 11, something like that. And so I would get my little weanlings in the spring, and I'd raise them up all summer and feed them and tend them, and all the way into winter. And in the winter, we would take them and we'd have them butchered up, and I'd sell them, so I'd have to play salesman among the community. And so I'd have most of a year's work in before I'd start to get any paycheck at all. And so I think that was really good training for me, to be able to put effort and stick-to-itiveness into something, knowing that the paycheck is down the road. And that's perfectly fine. And one of the things that's perfectly fine about that is you're going to appreciate that paycheck down the road just as much as you'd appreciate that paycheck today. You know, if you think, oh, I need the money, I need it now. Well, guess what? In a couple of months, when you otherwise might have gotten that paycheck, you're going to need it now. So what's the point, right? If you're not getting by today, then that paycheck's really not going to make the difference for you. But regardless, that's not the principle I want to talk about. It's just the delayed gratification. It's putting in the time into something. The honey business is no different. You know, I'll work these bees all the way from September all the way to September. You know, before I get any harvest and before I get any opportunity to even sell the fruits of my labors. And then it might take me a year to sell all of that product. So that's delayed gratification. And that's just because I grew up on a farm. And in a farmer, you get paid once a year. And so you need to conduct yourself accordingly, your businesses and your personal and your emotional state on, gee, I didn't get a paycheck this week.
So that's just a little principle that I think is important, especially to teach the younger people. And it's not just younger people have a problem with that concept. It's just that I'm saying younger people, because when you learn stuff like that when you're younger, you benefit from it your whole life. And when you get old like me, it's hard to learn anything. It's hard to change your mind. It's hard to train yourself. It's 9 a.m. And so I'm going to get in out of the cold here. It's not too cold. I'm not in the wind. And I'm going to go in and build some covers. Here's a quick comparison of some of the glues I've been using. Of course, my favorite glue, Type Bond 3, is an excellent glue. It's nice to work with. It's readily available normally, and it's economical in quantities. When I can buy it, I usually buy it in the gallon size. But they have supply chain problems, and it is not available. I've used up 2 gallons of it in my project so far with the pallets and the covers, and I got about 60, I think, covers left to do yet. So I've tried, I don't have a container here for it, but I tried a glue. It's a waterproof glue from Elmer's, and it was bad out of the store, so I had to take it back. It was kind of dried up, so I didn't really get a good comparison on that one. But it wasn't available. It was available only in this size container at the store. Okay. PL Premium. I use PL Premium on my pallets, on the underpinnings, the runners, and the risers. As far as I'm concerned, PL Premium is almost the granddaddy of glue. It'll glue almost anything together. Now, in a caulking tube like this, and a project like this, it's a little, you know, these top runners is not bad to handle, but it's a little difficult to handle. My process has to be a bit different. Plus, it's not that economical. We're looking at $8+ for this tube, and I think I got 4.5 covers made out of that, so I decided that that's not my first choice from an economic standpoint. From a quality standpoint, it's probably one of the best, and it's not the easiest to just manipulate for a smaller project. This is an Elmer's polyurethane glue. Now, PL Premium is a polyurethane glue, and I've never used a polyurethane. It's a waterproof glue, but I read on the forums guys talking about foaming, and I did this last evening before I went in and left it. I came out this morning, and it looks like a bunch of spray foam sticking out, so that's going to require a lot of cleanup and trimming. I think as far as adhesion and waterproofness, I think that's going to be one of the best. So I'm not sure. I might use this up because I don't use it in general in the shop. And it's been here quite a while, but it's still good. And so I'm gonna probably use that up. In desperation, I bought this gallon of Tight Bond 2. This is labeled as weatherproof. Not waterproof, but weatherproof. And their Tight Bond 3 is labeled as waterproof. This is definitely a more waterproof glue, better for outdoors. The people I talk to use Tight Bond 2 are very impressed with it, and they like its waterproof, weatherproof nature as well. So I'm going to use that as well. I like Tight Bond products. I like the handling. In my process of putting all this together, this works well for me. I can use my little dispenser here, which is makes it easy to spread the glue on various areas. And so that's about all I have to say about the glue. That's been one of my biggest pains with this whole thing. And it's interesting to note that this company's pains are not only COVID related. You know, we have a lot of supply chain issues with the COVID issues, people, you know, having staffing issues, people being sick or for whatever reason.
But this company had some technological issues that pretty much brought the company to its knees, and they were back ordered before that, and now they're back ordered even longer. So I'm not sure when I'm going to get that. I did order 2 gallons actually of the Elmer's version of this, but I don't think it's going to arrive in time even for this project. So hopefully I can use it up with frames and other equipment that I build when I get it, because it's certainly not cheap. So there's my glue challenge. There's something I've been doing here I want to share with you. And again, I don't know if I can do this one-handed, but just in the interest of time, I've been spreading this stuff just with my finger. Okay. So make a nice little film, and I want to demonstrate to you something that's called a rub joint. Okay, glue on my finger here. Okay, so what you need for a rub joint, you need good quality glue and a nice film of it. You need parts that are milled very well. So this has to be very flat, and this has to be very flat. But if I can do this with one hand, put this on here, and you see it's kind of slimy and it kind of moves around. Rub it a little bit, okay? And I can feel that tightening up. And you can do this, and you can make a good glue joint without any clamps or nails, okay? So I've rubbed that a bit, and it's getting pretty tight. And watch. What a joint that is. Okay, that's stuck right down there, and that's a joint. You can let that dry, and that'll be a good glue joint. Now, as a matter of course, I'm going to drive nails and everything in there as well, but I just wanted to show you that. That's called a rub joint, and it's a good woodworking joint under the right conditions and for the right purpose.
It's April the 7th, 2022. And it's just rained and snowed and heavy winds for the last 30 hours or so. It's just starting to calm down now. The snow stopped, I think, last night or this morning sometime. But it's still pretty windy. I'm sheltered here a bit for this particular wind direction. You can hear the eavesdrops melting here. But man, there's snow everywhere again. This is not going to do the condition of my apiary any good. And there's more rain in the forecast. I think Sunday, they say. The place is just almost flooded. You know, look at this. It's pretty flat in this country. It doesn't drain real well sometimes. And any of the obstruction will back up a bit of a pond. But today, the only thing planned today is covers. I've got 19 covers to build. So if I do well today, I can knock that off. And I'm done assembling covers for the customer. And I can get to trimming, finishing them up, packing them for shipping. And then we can start making movements toward actually making the trip out there. A little bit of a late start today. Provincial Bee Association meeting this morning, meeting on some fairly urgent and important issues. So it was kind of a special board meeting, and I think things went well. It's always I don't know about contentious. It's a very emotion-filled kind of topic we were discussing, and I'm not going to go into all that right here. It's not the place. But I think it went well, and I think there's progress being made. Which is great. It's a great bunch of people on the board, reasonable for the most part, and allow different ideas to be brought forth, and listen to reason, and action items that the board decides to be actionable. So that's why I'm kind of getting a late start, and I got a few little chores out here to do, but nothing too interesting, and then back in the wood shop, finish off these covers. And I'll sleep good tonight if I get those covers finished. So that's what that apiary looks like after the wind. Oh boy. It's still really cold out here. Look at how the snow, look at how the ice has formed here with the wind. The snow is caked to the side and then it kind of drops off after a while. It's just, it's depressing. I need these hives to get some warm weather and build up and have a good time, and not like this. This is not a good time.
You're looking at 200 assembled migratory covers. Of course, they all need to be trimmed. Once through the table saw and once around with the router. That's going to take a little while, but you know, it's not too bad. I can do that pretty fast. So I'm sure happy to be done this. I'm sure happy to get this order. Let's not, let's not discount the blessing that it is to get an order like this. This is exactly the kind of thing that I want to be doing in my winter season. So this one, the stage has come to an end. Now we can move on to the next stage. What I didn't show you yesterday was how the warming cabinet worked out. Now these have perfectly cooled down now, but as you can see, there are no crystals at all in these. And I'm confident that the honey is still high quality, not been overheated. So that's how that goes. Now I have to just box them up again. All my boxes here. And then off to market. It's always a bit unnerving running the blade 3 inches high. It sure whistles. And, there's a lot of it there. But this is the last trim on these. Well, there's the routing part, but on the table saw is the last trim. So just trim the side, cut that much off it. It's almost nothing. And that just makes a perfectly smooth joint there. This is almost unavoidable because the end cleat tends to splay out a little bit, and I can't make that shim too tight, but that really doesn't bother anything. It's all closed up because of the way. If I had put this end cleat and shim here, come out to the end and then try and fit this one between the two, then there might end up being a crack there. And that's why I put this small one in the middle, because then on assembly I can push this right up to that one and there's never a crack, even though you can see this here. There's never actually an opening into the beehive.
It's Friday, April 8th, 2022. End of the city today and outskirts thereof. A bunch of errands to do, a couple store visits. Gotta go to Bee Supply and pick up my feed and treatments for the spring season. And hopefully the weather is nice enough to get in there tomorrow and start applying some of that. 140, 144 colonies out there. It's gonna take me a while to get through one person. Especially it's so muddy. It's going to be time consuming to get around and difficult. You're just stuck in the mud all the time when you're walking around. So that's about all that's happening right now. I slept really good. I got all those covers assembled. So that was a really nice end to the day yesterday. I had planned, I had thought, well, I might get done the covers this week if I work, 4 days kind of thing, and it didn't even take me that long. I was interrupted by other stuff, so that worked out really nicely. I'm very happy about that. Back from the city, and everything went really well. Quite a few stops. I got one surprise honey order while I was there, so that was really nice. One of my regular customers, always nice to see her. And actually, it was nice to see her because she's a customer I often don't see. She orders, and then I just deliver to the door while she's at work. So she was home today, and that was nice. Had a little chat. Delivered to one of my stores. Actually, I delivered first order to a new store that I picked up. So the the salesman job is never complete. You know, always looking for new stores that might like to carry the product. And this one picked it up last week and placed an order. And I went to one of my regular stores, one of my best stores, actually. And so I have to check in on him regularly. And so he sells four SKUs that I have. And so I went in there to check. And three SKUs, he had enough. But one of them, he was pretty low on this one SKU. So I ran out to the truck and went through what I had. And I didn't bring any of that kind. So I guess I'll have to go back next week because he'll be out on that one anyway. He's got the other three descriptions to tide him over. So that went well. Picked up packed honey. I didn't deliver any today. I just kind of wanted to take a break from that for a bit. I mean, it always costs money, right? It costs a lot of money to pack honey. So I just decided to take a week or maybe two off from that. Went to the bee supply store and I picked up my patties and my mite treatments for the spring. I'll show you those patties. I'm trying something new this year, something that's highly recommended, and give it a go and see how it works out. So for years I've been using Manlakes Ultra B patties. There's 40 pounds in that box, so I've got 80 pounds of that. And I always just start with 1 pound per colony, so I've got 160 pounds here total. Manlakes Ultra B did score very well in Randy Oliver's trials on patty supplements. So, you know, my bees seem to always chew it up and be happy and build up and be healthy. So I'm not very scientific about it. The bees live, I'm good. But the bee supply guy, he said, you know, these global patties, you can't quite see that. Global patties, he said, that's 15% of real pollen. So they use real pollen to make those. And he told me that 40 pounds of the global is cheaper than 40 pounds of the Ultra B. So I said, you know, let's go half and half. I'm going to split these half and half among the colonies. See if I can see any difference. Certainly, if there's not a negative difference, then why not save the money? So I'll show you these in case you haven't seen these. And they're rather cold right now. They've been in the truck. So I unloaded them in the garage here, keep them warm until I feed them. I like the packaging. It's a nice flat package. So it goes under my cover. My half inch shim gives me space for that. So they seem to eat that up pretty good. And I actually had this conversation with him today, and I kind of have this conversation jovially, but I do believe it. I hear people say, well, they're eating it because they need it, or they're eating it because they can use it. I don't believe that at all. bees don't have the ability to reason, okay? I do, and I ate two teen burgers for lunch today. So, and I know that's not any good for me. I did it anyway, just because I like it. So what I'm saying here is bees get into all kinds of stuff. All animals get into all kinds of stuff.
because it's enticing to them somehow. And I do not believe that you can confidently say that this or that product or this or that substance is good for your bees because they're drawn to it, because they like it. That's not, I don't think that's an axiom to live by. But that's my opinion. You can believe otherwise if you choose. One of the examples, I'll give you an example of that. One of the examples in that trial that Randy Oliver did of pollen sub, he had a bit of an issue because in one yard he was testing it, the bees went and foraged a whole bunch of red mold spores off a tree, and they packed the colony right up with that stuff just as if it was pollen. They can't use it. It's no good for them. They have no use for it. You know, to me, that's an example. There's many, many other examples, but that's a pretty glaring one, I think. I don't think you could reasonably say, oh, the bees wanted that. The bees could use that. I don't think so. Mold spores, nothing like pollen. Okay. So this is well, that's a nice package. So it's a little bit longer. It's very soft. And you can obviously tell that it's real pollen. Or, you know, largely real pollen. What did it say? 15% real pollen. So, yeah. We'll feed them that. We'll feed them side by side with the Ultra Bee, and we'll see what happens. And see if we have one group that kind of performs a little better. Maybe not. Who knows? So the weather was delightful today. I think it's 3 or 4 degrees right now, but it feels so much warmer. That sun is so hot, which is nice. There's water everywhere, as you can see. Another big snowstorm next week, they're talking. What are they talking? 8 or 9 degrees tomorrow. Cloudy though, so that may work for me. Trying to work in the bee yard tomorrow. But anyway, so this is Friday, closing off Friday. I'm going to go put this together and we'll upload it so you can see it. And hope tomorrow goes well with assessments and feeding bees and treating bees.